generally we're seeing, and this started kind of back end of last year, an improvement in growth almost across the board in emerging markets, with a few exceptions. So growth compared to the developed world, we think, is going to kind of re-accelerate. Last year, a lot of central banks were cutting interest rates pretty much across the board in emerging markets. Because of the improvement in growth we're going to see this year, we think a lot of central banks will be on hold. Some central banks might even be raising rates. A couple like Mexico and Russia, we think, will still be cutting rates. But overall, we think the easing cycles generally in the EM have kind of come to an end. I mean, most of the risks we identify are outside of EM or exogenous to EM. There isn't a lot of main large kind of elections that are going to occur in emerging markets this year. A lot of them happen the past few years, like in Brazil and Mexico, for example. So election risk, we think, is not very prevalent in emerging markets for this year. Probably the key exogenous risk we're seeing is the US election. You know, if the market starts to price in a Democratic win, that's going to be probably bad for, obviously, the US stock market and risk appetite in general. So the main election risk, we think, is US election risk. And then EM specific, there aren't that many troublesome countries. There's two countries we think might default this year, Argentina and Lebanon, but these countries now represent a tiny part of the index. And also, bonds in those countries trade 40 cents on the dollar, so the market has already anticipated the eventual default, so it wouldn't come as a surprise. So yeah, overall, most of the risks are kind of quite contained, we think, but the US election is probably the one we're most concerned about. Yeah, so I mean, last year was a very good year for all things EM. Hard currency credit in particular did very well. So in certain segments of that market, we're not seeing a huge amount of value. Mainly the IG names, high quality emerging market sovereigns, where spreads are at multi-year lows. The value we're seeing is in the kind of high yield names, places like Egypt, Turkey, where spreads and yields are still very high and the macro and political story is very solid. So we're seeing value there in hard currency. And then more broadly, because EM currencies, we think, are cheap, they haven't done very well over the past few years because central banks have stopped cutting rates. And now EM is starting to grow again. We think there's a lot of value generally in emerging market currencies as well for next year. So that segment of the asset class, we think, is probably the one that will outperform this year. Well, like I just said, currencies we think for this year will be a strong performing asset class, maybe even kind of low double-digit returns. So we're favoring that in our portfolios. In terms of euros versus dollars, we're kind of indifferent. A lot of EM countries, and that's been a trend over the last year actually, is that they're starting to tap the euro market. Sovereigns are tapping the euro market. For example, Ukraine issued a euro-denominated bond last week. So if we see value in euros versus dollars on a swap basis, we'll obviously buy the euro-denominated bonds. But it's we can buy both in the funds that we all the funds that we manage. But that is a big trend, though, because obviously with euro rates being low or negative in some countries, a lot of EM sovereigns are issuing in euros to take advantage of that. So we have a proprietary ESG framework that we developed over the last 7 or 8 years, specifically on EM sovereigns, and there's about 20 indicators that go into that framework. Because governance factors are very important and social factors are very important in the emerging market, we weight the S and the G pillars more. We give a 50% weight to governance factors and 30 to social, and then 20 to environmental. So that's our framework. How we use it is to kind of predict changes and improvements in the overall ESG score. So a good example is Ukraine, actually, where, you know, that government there was elected on a mandate to root out corruption in that country. So governance factors are improving. We didn't think that was in the price. So one of the reasons why we are very long and overweight Ukraine is because of these governance improvements. And The other way we use it is we screen out some of the poor performers on the E, the S, or the G. So that's allowed us to, or stopped us and prevented us from buying credits like Venezuela and Lebanon that are now, you know, bond prices are very distressed. So we use it for negative screening as well. So that's our approach to EM sovereign ESG.